Hallelujah. Welcome, everybody. If we can all stand as we get ready for a time of worship.
You have the name above all names, and you are worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing how great is our God.
Let's sing that to him this morning. You have the name.
You have the name above all names, and you are worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing how great is our God.
We declare that again. How awesome is he?
You have the name above all names, and you are worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing how great is our God.
We worship you today. How great.
And how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Sing that again, how great.
Great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great and how great is our God.
How great. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's give a clap offering to the Lord. Amen. Just quickly turn to the person on your left and right. If you don't know their names, introduce yourself. Just say, hello, my name is this. I'm so glad that you're here. Let's worship God together.
to God with a voice of triumph. Oh, clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Oh, clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Oh, clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a
voice. Shout to God.
Shout unto God. Shout unto God. Shout unto God. Shout unto God. Shout unto God.
Hey! nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? And nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious, and oh, precious.
I don't know about you, but my heart is kind of bursting with anticipation as to what the Lord is going to do in this hour. But, you know, we have not come here to be an audience, but we have come here to be God's worshipers today. And so I have no doubt that the Lord will touch us. But what if this worship was all about us being united of one spirit to make Him great, to declare His greatness, to really, that God would captivate us, that He would amaze us once again, not just for the sake of my own satisfaction, but so that we can make much of who God is. Amen? So if I could lead us into one corporate prayer together before we go into the Word. So let's take this time to pray together. And I think Pastor Mantofa really likes the Korean prayer. So, you know, in our English side, we cry out the name of Jesus three times instead of Chuya. It's like our Korean-American version. But we cry out Jesus, not because it's a religious activity, but because as we heard last night, there is a presence of God in His name, and there is a power of God in that name. So if I may ask all of us here, whether you're from our church or not, whether you're from Indonesia, here in the States, Korea, wherever you may be, if we could call out the name of Jesus, we could cry out His name three times, and let's pray at this moment that God would be so thoroughly glorified in the hearts of His people, that we will be so amazed by Him once again, that we will make much of who He is here in this place, shall we? So on the count of three, let's cry out the name of Jesus three times, and let's pray that this worship will magnify who Jesus is, and that He will make Himself even greater and greater inside of our hearts. Let's pray together. One, two, three. Jesus! 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 Sweet Jesus, may Your name be sweeter than honey here in the presence of Your people. Lord, may there be such a reverence for You here in this place that You will return, Lord God, the fear of the Lord in the hearts of Your people, and that You would draw us ever closer to You in intimacy. God, would You restore first love in this hour? God, would You amaze us, captivate us once again, that we may stand in childlike wonder before You. Lord, we are not here, Lord God, to be an audience, to observe a spectacle, but we have come, Lord God, to worship You, to be active participants, to seek You, to wait for You in this hour, and to confess, Lord, that You are the one that we want. And You are the one that we so want to meet. Jesus, would You kiss us, Lord God, here in this hour? And may we, the bride, kiss You back. So Lord, we love You. We love Your name here in this place. Be glorified, Lord Jesus. And it's in Your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may grab your seats. Well, we want to welcome all of you guys here at Grace Church. My name is June. I'm one of the pastors here at our church. And for some of you guys, we know that you are here for the first time this weekend, so we want to sincerely welcome all of you. A couple of announcements before we get right into the Word. So tonight at 5 p.m., we're going to have another evening session. It will be back in the Vision Center where we had worship last night or even this morning. If you don't know where it is, it's like straight that way in the big silver building. If you still can't find it, just ask one of us and we will lead you to that place. So 5 o'clock tonight. In the atrium, which is straight back, the hallway straight back to the sanctuary, we have some coffee that is being sold, and as well as t-shirts. So feel free to help yourself with that. And also, the restrooms are there too, okay? So the women's restroom is like all the way in the back, okay? So I know sometimes it's hard to see, so just wanted to let you guys know. And so without further ado, once again, we're so honored and we're so delighted to have Pastor Philip Mantofa, who has been such an awesome man of God in the Muslim world of Indonesia, and the senior pastor of Rosa Sharon Church, which is now approaching 100,000 people. And we're so excited and delighted of what the Lord is doing in and through him in Indonesia. And we're also very honored and glad to have him here. So as I invite him up, if we could welcome him with a warm applause.
Hallelujah. 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 Yes. How are you doing? I recall the last time I was here, God moved in such a way, people could barely stand. Right? Were you here last year? Yeah? Oh, praise the Lord. If you were not here last year, let's bring last year to this year. And let's ask Jesus to touch everyone, okay? All right. You know, tonight, this afternoon at 5 p.m., hold on, it's my... Yeah. Because faith comes from hearing, it's really serious, so it's got to get...
And Jesus just calmed the storm. Come to talk about Jesus, I thought that brother looked a little bit like Jesus. Don't you love Jesus? I recall once when I was just born again, I was doing my quiet moment with him, my devotion. It was not in the morning, it was in the afternoon as I returned from school. I was about to graduate high school then, grade 12. I was in Vancouver, Canada. And as I was singing by myself in the laundry room of our house, I was so mesmerized by his presence. And I mentioned his name over and over again because I loved that name so much. I said, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord, Emmanuel, God is with us, blessed Redeemer, living Word. And I say it again, Jesus, Lord Jesus. It's not like people who are calling his name for profanity. And when they bump their head on a wall and they say, oh, Jesus. It's not like that at all. It's that adoration. I adored that name. I said, Jesus, over and over again. And I finished my devotion that reluctantly because I had to do something else. And it was over time already. With Jesus, you will always go over time. When you have first love, you're going to be the last one to leave the room. That's how love, first love, that's how first love goes. Always, it will make you come the earliest and it will make you go the latest. And as I fake it at my room, my prayer room, which was actually a laundry room, I saw all my friends in that house where I was living in. There are a few friends of mine who were actually living in that house. They rented our space because I got a big house in Canada. And I saw some of them. I heard people crying inside the room, and that person wasn't so spiritual. And I saw another one slain on the floor in the living room. I don't know whether that's got to do with what happened in my devotion room, but it's certainly that fruit that day didn't fall far from the tree. And people were all being touched by Jesus in that house where I was living in. Let me tell you, the name of Jesus has got power. It's never changed. It doesn't change, my friends. So I want you to understand that He's not only powerful, He's so loving. This week, I am truly captivated by the Song of Solomon, this one book in the Bible of all the 66 books that usually people avoid. And they do not like their children to read that book. It's too sensuous. It's not. You know, Jesus is romantic to His church, but not in the physical sense, not in the erotic sense as human love usually does or usually is. It's not that. We can read the book of Song of Solomon or Song of Songs to understand better the love between a man and a woman, but the best way of understanding this book, the best comprehension is to take it from the perspective of Jesus' loving relationship to His church. So I've not succeeded to surpass first chapter in two sessions, so I might as well just jump over the wall and right away touch on chapter 2 with you, all right? Otherwise, I'll never get over chapter 1. If you are with me, if you've been with me here these past two sessions, and this is the third one, I want you to know that I want to explain every single verse, like a few hours each verse, but it's not possible because of time restraint. The sessions are limited, so let's now begin right away in chapter 2 with me. Chapter 2, I'm not going to touch on every verse also, because a few days ago, I spoke to our Indonesian crowd from chapter 2, verse 1 till 3. But right now, I'm going to go to verse 1 to chapter 4. So I will now start with verse 5 to begin with. But before that, let's read Song of Songs, chapter 2, verse 1. I am a rose of Sharon, a lily of the valleys. Like a lily among thorns is my darling among the maidens. Like an apple tree among the trees of the forest is my lover among the young men. I delight to sit in his shade, and his fruit is sweet to my taste. He has taken me to the banquet hall, and his banner over me is love. The first four verses, I'm just going to skim through. All right? Simply saying, hereby, the bride of Christ, the church, claims that she is a rose of Sharon. Sounds fancy, but a rose of Sharon is but a common flower in Israel. It's not really that special. So don't ever feel that you are special. You are a commoner as I am. Jesus is royal. We are special because He married us. Your status has been upgraded. And we're no longer orphans, spiritually speaking. We are now children of God. We can call Him Father. How lucky and blessed and privileged we are. You know, Jesus is never lucky to have you and me. Trust me, when He has you and I, He has more troubles. But we are certainly lucky and blessed to have Him. The honor is ours. God is not honored to have us. It's the other way around. We are a lily of the valleys. That's even more lowly. It's a lily, you see. It's more lowly. It rhymes. Like a lily among thorns is my darling among the maidens. Now this was Jesus. This is Jesus' reply to us. No. Don't be so humble. Even though Jesus is teaching us to be humble all the time, sometimes when we are too humble, He's going to lift us up. He doesn't like to see us forever in the low. He would say, well, nah, my darling, you are like a lily among thorns. Wow. Instead of lifting us up too highly, it's not very good for us because we ought to have fear of heights somehow, spiritually speaking. Don't be too high on the sky. But the Lord instead downgraded, He has downgraded our rifles. Well, I know, okay, sure, no, you're a fat lily of the valley, but the other ones are even lower, so you're the highest. See, sometimes God doesn't need to lift us up. He just needs to humble our enemies. Simple, huh? You know, God doesn't have to lift me up because I'm most of the time not ready to be lifted up. So instead, He humbles my enemy. That's another way of doing it. God is so smart. Like an apple tree among the trees of the forest, now the bride says to Him, is my lover among the young men. All right, apple tree, lemon tree. I'm not going to explain this one. You want to know the meaning or the significance of it? Ask these first two rows. They are the Indonesians to whom I spoke this message to. You can ask them, what's the significance of an apple tree? You guys have to be able to answer. Otherwise, you won't go to heaven. Nah, I'm just kidding. But you got to answer them. Someone asked, is my lover among the young men? I delight to sit in his shade, and his fruit is sweet to my taste. Isn't that wonderful? Jesus is like an apple tree. Oh, okay. I'm gonna tell you the meaning of it. If you cannot, you know, by saying that Jesus is your apple tree is pretty much comfortable for you to sit under it. It's shady. It's got a lot of fruits. If any of those fruits fall onto the ground, consider that your lucky day. You're not stealing any fruit. You're not going to end up like Adam. You're going to just have to take a bite, an apple a day. You keep the Satan away. I delight to sit in his shade. Meaning that if he's your apple tree, don't rush it when you're doing your devotion. Sit under the tree. Enjoy it. It's not a routine. It's not like you've got to do it. If you don't do it, you're not going to end up in hell, like what I said to the jokingly just now. No, it's not that. There's no scare in his kingdom. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans chapter 8, verse 1. So there's no more scare. With Jesus, it's all love. There's no more scare. The fear of God isn't scary. It's fear of hurting someone we love. It's love. It's not scare. You got it? Now you understand already what apple tree is. Meaning that you like to sit under his feet. Or exactly at his feet is even better. Under his feet, he's not going to trample all over you. And he has taken me to the banquet hall, and his banner over me is love. Isn't that good? Your anointing is love. If some of you are very concerned whether you're anointed, simply this, just love the Lord your God with all your heart and love other people the same. Trust me, the anointing will pursue you. The anointing will employ you. You'll never be or never go unemployed. So if you want to increase in your anointing, simply keep loving and loving more. You cannot be loved more because you've been loved the most. His love is the utmost. But you could grow in the department of loving. Being loved, you can. You can realize more that you are loved. But you cannot be more loved. There's nothing you do or don't do that can make you loved less or more by Jesus, because He has loved you max, to the max. He's loved you to the moon and back, people say. Oh, Jesus surpasses the moon. He's loved you to heaven, and He's coming back. Don't believe a thing people say. I love you to the moon and back. You've never even stepped a foot on the moon. Jesus is in heaven already and he's coming back. Come on, baby. Give God a big hand. I'll tell you. My goodness. And his banner over me is love. You want to be anointed? Because faith, even faith works through love, the Bible says. You know, you can be anointed. You need to be anointed. You know, you've never been appointed. You probably would never get anointed. So, why am I anointed today? It's because the people trust me. The people appointed me. Even though it's Jesus who has chosen me, but the people appointed me as their senior pastor. When I was appointed that, then I was anointed with that. So I think there's that point in David's life where he got poured oil upon his head. And then afterwards, he was called God's anointed. Because he was appointed by Samuel. Even though it's by God, ultimately. But it's by Samuel also. And he got anointed. But how did David grow from that size of an anointing, killing bears and lions? I think we could agree that must be the anointing. You cannot kill a lion. Some of you are even scared at the sight of cockroaches. You can't kill a lion like that bare hand. But how did he grow from that size of an anointing, which seemed rather too great for a young boy, and yet it wasn't great enough to God who was giving that anointing to him? So God had to grow. God wanted to grow his anointing to a different size now. He's going to upsize his anointing. David grew it through love. He was loving God when he was alone. He was writing psalms and all that. He was always found at the foot of the apple tree. Jesus in the Old Testament. He was at his father's backyard. It was wonderful to see how he grew from that size of anointing to a new size already and killed Goliath as a result of it. Goliath is a different story. I think he could kill a lion because he was 3 meters big. This guy was huge. If he were to dunk a basketball rim, he's not going to break the glass. If this guy, Goliath, was dunking, he would bring down the whole stadium. That's the difference between him and Shaquille O'Neal. Let me tell you, no kidding, this guy. But David killed him like a cockroach. It's like that. I didn't even need to touch you. See? You're dead already. I didn't even need to touch you. Just like that. Receive. He's on the floor. Powerful David. It's not because he had power. Because he had love. He had love. How did my anointing grow? Come to think of it. Not because I prayed more. I fasted more. Yes, all that. But it's not that. Those are the keys. Those are just not the keys. Those are keys, not the keys. But this is the key. L-O-V-E. Love. Not just love, but loving God wholeheartedly and loving people fervently. Amen? His banner over me is love. Don't worry about how much anointed you are. Just worry how much loving you are. Simple. Leave that department, how much anointed you are, to the Lord who's giving that anointing to you. I never worry. When I saw someone under the power of demons and I couldn't stand it because my heart was moved by compassion, trust me, deliverance is inside. When I saw the lame, the paralyzed, those with cancers and before me, I wasn't thinking of me to save myself from that situation or from embarrassment if that person didn't get healed after I prayed for him. I prayed for them. No, I wasn't thinking of me. If you're thinking of you, Jesus would be less in you. But I was thinking of that person and I said, Lord, do something already. Hey, I think I can do something with the Lord. I'm not going to just ask the Lord to do it. The Lord has already given the key. I'm going to do it with the Lord, and the Lord's going to do it through me and with me. Hey, come here in Jesus' name. Be free of your cancer. In Jesus' name, walk already. Amen. There you go. I love children. They know what I'm talking about the kingdom of God, because they own the kingdom of God. Isn't that just fantastic when you just don't feel a thing about you, but feel everything about that person who's suffering, and then you just give your life, you just throw yourself at God's feet, that apple tree, that fruit of the apple tree, just thrust yourself in the hands of God for Him to use you, and boom, miracles just happen. And after miracles, after they happen, you didn't even realize that these are happening. Just about when you're just about to realize what was happening, God is moving you on already to the next need before you. So you got no time to count your reward. You got no time. You got no time to be proud. I got no time. I'm on the way. I've not arrived, and I'm not arriving here. Whatever miracle God could do right now, even if He raises the dead to life, I have not arrived today. I will have arrived when you hear this news. Pastor Philip Mantova is dead. Don't believe a thing, because I shall not die. Because Jesus says, whoever believes in me, he will not die. That day I just pass away. I will be more alive than all of you reading that news someday. But don't worry, you're not going to read the news, because I'm going to bury you, not the other way around. Yeah, sometimes I become like this. I speak like this when I lack sleep. Are you blessed?
Yes.
Hello? Yeah. If you're blessed, give God a big hand. Come on. Oh, wonderful Savior, Jesus. Where were we? The anointing, right? My anointing is love. All right, strengthen me with raisins, refresh me with apples, for I am faint with love. Oh, this is beautiful. Verse 5. Now, I can move on already to the next verse. Strengthen me with raisins. Raisins are, again, as the Rose of Sharon is, raisins are not anything extraordinary. Raisin cakes are not truffle cakes. They're cheap. Cheap things will do when you fall in love, you see. You don't need expensive dinners when you fall in love. Everything becomes expensive. A demanding Christian is no longer in love with Jesus. You know, strengthen me. I thought she would say strengthen me with jewelry, because diamonds are girl's best friend. But the bride doesn't say that. She says, strengthen me with raisins. Just, you know, it's your presence. It's not your presence. Am I saying it correctly? It's your presence, not your presence. It's your presence, not your presence. Even you bring me a diamond right now, it would be no difference to me than just a raisin. But Pastor Philip, I'm a girl. Not true. But I'm speaking about your relationship with Jesus. Small blessings, big blessings make no difference. Makes no difference to those whose hearts have belonged to Him. Strengthen me with raisins. A little blessing will make me happy. But some Christians are in the overdose department. Oh no, this type of blessings don't work on me no more. This is too little for me. Maybe 10 years ago it would make me smile, but now it cannot even make me grin. No, you gotta increase your dosage of your blessing for me. Raisins? Are you kidding me? No! Strengthen me with Wagyu beef. Anyone, any Christian who's cold-hearted, or even worse, lukewarm in their spirit, trust me, they're the most demanding ones in churches, in ministries, in lives. For me, strengthen me with raisins. Really, when I love ministry, I do not care whether I'm going to eat bibimbap or pizza, Pastor. I'll take anything so long you don't give me stones and snakes to eat. But snakes are delicious, actually. You know, if it were not, if Adam were Korean or Chinese, you continue the sentence. The fruit would just would remain there on the tree. The snake they would eat. If Adam were Asian, oh my goodness. That snake didn't stand no chance, man. Raisins will do. Oh, this is not enough anymore. I gotta, at church, in church, you gotta, I gotta see the church on a certain level to make me hang in the church. It's gotta have some, I'm not saying that the church should go on, you know, should go the primitive way. I think we ought to do our best, not only for God, but for our congregation. But it's not this. These are not the point. You know, I've got to have certain lightings and LEDs and facilities. The chairs have got to feel at least business class, if not first class. I don't think, you know, sometimes for church, it's good that we have been poor before. That's where we made the first member strong. Those who eat raisins and smile and say, I'm so happy as long as I'm with you, honey. My goodness, marry that person. I'm not saying that we should go back to poverty. Being poverty-minded is as bad as being prosperity-minded. What I'm saying is the best thing to do is to be Christ-minded, not facility-minded, not blessing-minded, but the blesser-minded. Amen. Amen. Strengthen me with raisins. Refresh me with apples. Again, the apple tree, the apples, apple tree, apples. She's not talking about a real apple. She's talking about the beautiful romantic moments she has had with her lover under the tree. That's the presence of the groom that she was after, that she pursued, that she coveted. This is a beautiful picture. For I am faint with love. Here. The bride admits to being sick. But this is no ordinary sickness. This is love sickness. For I am faint with love. In another translation, it reads like this. For I am love sick. You know, there is a certain hormone that the body produces that will wet all our brain when we fall in love. So that those who fall in love could even write songs like this. When I fall in love, it will be forever, or I'd never fall in love. He's blinded already. It's all or nothing. I'll fall in love with you, or I'll not fall in love at all. I'm ready even to be a eunuch. If you don't understand, don't know what a eunuch is, it's fine. So there's that hormone that the body produces as someone falls in love that causes that person to feel the thrill of falling in love. In fact, that hormone could also cause you to lose appetite. Food is no longer that appealing to you. Whether you're broken heart, especially if you're broken hearted. If you're not broken hearted, if you're so thrilled with love, sometimes you can't even tell the difference whether this is too salty or too sweet. When your heart is filled with your sweetheart, anything is not so sweet. You don't know the difference between too sweet or less or not sweet. So that kind, that hormone, I cannot pronounce it because it's too long. The term, it's very long. And that hormone, usually the duration of it in our body is just for 5 years. What should we do after 5 years? Let's divorce our first love? No. You should move on to the next hormone. If I'm not mistaken, it's called oxytocin. It is a hormone that is found in a mother that is nursing her baby. It is a hormone that binds a woman with the child she has just given birth to recently. This is a hormone that will move you on forward from attraction, thrill, to attachment. So after 5 years, after one gets married, you must be able to say to yourself, once I could live with that person, but after 5 years, I cannot live without her. That's attachment. But crazily, in this world, many celebrity marriages, especially, they don't always last more than 5 years because they're running out of hormones. No longer that which wets their brain with thrill and the loss of appetite. They're seeking a new thrill in a new girl or a new boy. So I think the same goes spiritually for our relationship with Christ. If you can't stand the test of time after 5 years being a Christian, and you're still in love, and that love, the Lord will label it first love. Even though first love is not tested the first 5 years. First love is after someone knows Jesus for 25 years, and you're still in love with Jesus. Jesus, that's first love, my friend. That's like having a PhD in love. You can teach people how to love Jesus already. So therefore, after a few years knowing Jesus, some people get puzzled. How come in the past, when I worship, I could just cry, I would just shed in tears, but now I don't feel anything? Oh, come on. Get it over with, this hormonal stuff. Let's get on to the next thing, the real deal, the oxytocin. Let's now be attached to Jesus. Once you fell in love with Him, now you cannot live without Him. That's when you say to Him, Jesus, I love you. Though the seasons may change, still your love will remain. Jesus, I love you. Know that every word that I'm speaking now is true. Yes, I do. I love you. It's when you say to the Lord, Lord, apart from you, I can do nothing. It's you that I need. You're all I want. You're all I want. You're all I ever needed. You're all I want. Tell me that you are near. It's when you come to that point in life when you say, everything is meaningless if Jesus is not in it. It's no longer shedding tears only. Even though I still do, I do shed tears from time to time. But it's no longer just my tears now. My whole body becomes my tears. My whole life becomes my tears. I no longer want to survive anything. I no longer want to live through anything. I don't want to go from here to anywhere if Jesus is not with me. It's that kind of love Moses had for the God of Israel. You're going to go into the Canaanite land. You're going to conquer the promised land as I promised you to, but I'm not going with you. I'm going to send my angel to represent me because the people have rejected me. Go ahead, Moses, bring your people into the land flowing with milk and honey. I said, I have no milk and honey. You are my water of life. You're my life-giving source. You are my milk and honey with capital M and a capital H. Without you, those mean nothing to me. Unless you go with me, I'm not going anywhere. Huh? Isn't this what you're living for? You know how important the land of Canaan too was to Moses? When finally God forbid him from entering because of a certain sin he did, he begged the Lord to the point of humiliation until the Lord has had enough and said, stop it, don't ask me anymore. So that's how badly he wanted it. Even so, Moses wanted God even more badly than that. I am faint with love. I am lovesick. There is deeper fulfillment in attaching to Jesus than just being attracted to him. That's when a relationship is moving forward into a new ground called partnership. The relationship stays, but it's just gotten upgraded. That's when not only you learn to trust the Lord, that's when you know the Lord can trust you. Isn't that powerful? Not everybody has come to that stage yet. This is called the next phase of spiritual growth. That's why this time to GMI and to Grace Korean Church, I've brought a message about having an intimate relationship with the Lord. Because I think this is a new ground we ought to find ourselves upon. This is called the holy ground, where there are angels all around. That's when you don't even need to use any force to speak the name of Jesus before heavenly authority will take place in that room where you are. This is when you just whisper the name of Jesus and all hell will run away from you. That's when all of Satan's forces know, don't mess with this guy. He's not calling a name. He's calling a person. While the rest, the others, they're just calling a name. They're just trying their luck. Jesus. They're just trying their luck. But this person, he's calling someone he knows intimately. This is the difference between ordinary and extraordinary. Anointed and more anointed, or anointed and not anointed. This is the difference between blessing, you ready, and power. That's the difference. I want to encourage you to be that church, a church with authority, believers with authority. Oh, don't you love Jesus? If you love Jesus, give God a big hand. His left arm is under my head, and his right arm embraces me. Daughters of Jerusalem, I charge you by the gazelles and by the does of the field. Do not arouse or awaken love until it so desires. His left arm is under my head, and his right arm embraces me. This is a very intimate position. Left arm under the head. Right arm embraces. It's like how God created the world. It's how Elisha resurrected that boy. And it's how Jesus hugs his church. Do you know that when we sing the song, He touched me. Oh, He touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something wonderful happened, and now I know He touched me and made me whole. I must have my son over here. I'm going to use you as an illustration. Over the years, I've used you for many things. He's my son, yeah? He's taller than I am, but not more handsome. He's got feet the size of submarines. I once warned him, if his feet grew longer, I would not buy him shoes no more. So hard to find him shoes the size of 49 and a half or 50. I said, I'm just gonna make a hole in the front of each shoe and he could grow his thumb forward. When you sing, he touched me, how do you think Jesus touches you when you feel his presence as you worship? Or if you don't feel it, it's the same. It's factual. It's the truth. But if you feel the presence of God, how do you think he touches you? He touched me. Like that? Oh, he touched me. Like this? And all the joy that floods my soul. This is not how Jesus touches you. This is how pastors touch you. Because pastors cannot touch you the way, according to this description. Because it is not healthy. But husband and wife or father and children could do that. Even your children, if they are already grown up to become adults, you cannot hug them certain ways, right? Jeremy, when he was younger, his favorite position was sitting on my shoulders. If he did that now today, I would go to see Jesus right away. All right? So this is how pastors touch you and our people when people pray for you. But actually, in the unseen world, that description is fitting how Jesus truly touches someone. He touched me. It's like this. Oh, left arm under me. Oh, he touched me. You see that? Stay there, boy. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. It doesn't stop here. The right arm embraces. The word embraces, it keeps moving. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. Trust me, if he touches you this way, everything will be made whole. You need not fear of anything anymore except him letting go. This is what it means when he touches you. You want to stay here forever? Or you want to go back to your seat? It's a hard choice. I think he wants to stay here forever. I love my son. God bless you. That's what the scripture means. Sometimes when you read the scriptures, you just read on. Oh, his left arm is under me. His right arm embraces. All right, next. You don't do next. Scripture is so deep. Wait for me until I stay in America for 1 year. I'm going to expose all the beauty of the scriptures to you. But that ain't going to happen. So you got to find the meaning of every scripture under the apple tree yourself. And he wants to touch you today. He touched me. Oh, he touched me like you touch your daughter. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. I recall when I was dancing with Vanessa on her sweet 17. In Indonesia, it's 17, not 16. You grew up too quickly in America. Something, I did a slow dance with my daughter, happened, and now I know he touched me
and made me whole. Amen.
When I hug my youngest, now he's already grown a lot taller. But before, he likes to be on my lap. It's not like he touched me, I play rough with him because we're boys. Oh, he touched me, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. But it's still playing with God. Jacob wrestled with God, and God let him win. And God even admitted, you won. But so you will not, your head will not puff up. I'm going to show you, actually, I let you win. And then he walked like this ever since, Jacob. But I didn't do that to Warren. Something wonderful happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. I take every struggle I have in my life, I don't take them as struggle against Satan. Yes, there's spiritual warfare, but every struggle of my life, I take that as a wrestling match with my God, where he's going to let me win all the time. That's how beautiful of a relationship I have with him. I don't see things the way you see things, because, you know, I look at things through spectacles, not these ones. Another pair I have that is unseen to you. I see everything. People say, oh, I've got problems. I say, I've got opportunities to wrestle with God on this. Why should you complain if you have a lot of problems in life? To me, they are my crowns. When I'm lonely, that's the best opportunity for me to call him, Father, you're all I got. When I'm in the low, I feel like all the pressure, all the weight of the world is upon me. I said, Lord, you got no choice now. You don't want me dead, right? You died to make me live. You got to lift this burden up for me. I can. I'm not God. You are. And he said, all right, you got me. He lifted it. Let me tell you, I don't see things the way many people see things. And I don't preach to give you information. I preach to change your paradigm, to change your mind. I preach in the hope that my faith is contagious enough to change the way you perceive everything. And I do hope the first thing that you need to change is how you see him touch you. It's not just like that. It's like this. Let's all stand to our feet. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And all the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. I'm imagining that the Lord is slow dancing with some of you. He touched me. Touched me, and all the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me. And make me whole. Enough with the old song, they cannot follow. So let's sing a song that we all can follow. Jesus, I love you. Radio, please lead the way. Go ahead. Do you love Jesus?